Hello friends, welcome to TalentSprint. Ever wondered what successful students do that you don't? What is the secret behind their success in these highly competitive exams? What is that one thing which can help you crack these competitive exams? Well, the most certain answer for this question is the approach that you have for solving various questions in your aptitude exams. I'm sure most of you feel that even I can answer this question, but what is the reason that I'm left behind? Well, the difference between a winner and the others is that others know how to answer the question, but winners know how to answer the question in a smart way. So in this video today, I'm going to show you a few methods of answering questions in smart ways. Let us look at what are the four ways of solving questions from aptitude. And I shall explain this to you with the help of a few examples. The first question here, it says the principal amount is 20,000. Time period is 2 years and the rate of interest is 14% per annum. So what is the compound interest? Well, the first method of solving any question in aptitude is the traditional method, the conventional method where we use the step-by-step procedure to arrive at the final answer. But we end up wasting a lot of time in most of the cases. Like in this question, if you go by the formula of compound interest, which says CI equals to P into 1 plus R by 100 whole to the power of T minus P. Or if we take P common, we have this formula for CI, right? P of 1 plus R by 100 whole power T minus 1. Now all we need to do here is substitute the values. 20,000, rate of interest is 14 and time period is 2 here. So substitute the values, simplify, do the calculation and you'll get the final answer. But I'm sure most of you understand that we'll take at least 2 minutes to solve all those equations and arrive at the final answer. So what is the second method of answering this question here? Well, the second method, which is different from the traditional method, is to use your basic concepts, your basic fundamentals of answering questions without using the conventional formula. Like in this case, if you are strong in your basics of percentages, you would understand that compound interest can be calculated using the concept of effective percentage, which says that effective percentage can always be calculated as A plus B plus AB by 100, where A and B are two percentages. So compound interest is also an effective percentage case. And hence, we can say that the compound interest here in terms of percentage will be equal to A plus B plus AB by 100, where A is the rate of interest in first year and B is the rate of interest for the second year. Now, generally, the questions that we get in the exam have got the same rate of interest for both the years. So in our case, A is 14 and B also is 14. So let's just substitute and find out what is the compound interest in terms of percentage. So A plus B plus A into B by 100. What do we get? 14 plus 14 plus 14 into 14 by 100. Now 14 squared is 196. 196 upon 100 is 1.96. So 14 plus 14, 28. 28 plus 1.96. This will come out to be 29.96%. So what we understand from this approach is that the compound interest in this case will be 29.96%, or approximately 30%. 30% of what? The principal amount, right? Again, if you are strong in your concept here, you would know that the interest is always calculated on the principal amount. So we can say that the compound interest in this case is 30% of 20,000, which is 6,000 rupees. So that's how, using this second method where we follow the basic fundamentals and the basic concept, we can arrive at the answer much faster without following the traditional or the conventional method. So the answer for this question would be 6,000, and I'm sure you will be able to do this in less than 30 seconds in your competitive exam. Now you might wonder that why did we take 30% as the answer, because the actual calculation says it should be 29.96%. Well, the reason here is that in competitive exams, most of the times the options are given in such a way that we can do an approximate calculation and arrive at the correct answer. Since the options are generally not too close to each other, here we can assume that 29.96 is approximately 30%, right? And 30% of principal amount here is 6,000. So the option which is closest to 6,000 can be marked as the correct answer. And moreover, we should also understand that the answer has to be slightly lesser than 6,000. So if at all we find two options that are close to 6,000, but one is less than 6,000 and the other being more than 6,000, we can easily eliminate the wrong answer here, because we know that answer is, actual answer is 29.96%, which should be less than 6,000, right? So the idea here is to use the concept of effective percentage and do an approximate calculation to mark the answer in less than 30 seconds without following the lengthy and time-consuming conventional method. So this is the second method of answering the questions from aptitude, where we use our basic knowledge and the concepts that we have discussed in answering the questions without using the formula or the conventional method. Let us now look at the third method of answering questions from aptitude, and this is known as the substitution method. Well, there are many types of questions where we can follow the method of substitution, right? This is like reverse engineering. All we need to do is put the option answers back in the question and see which option satisfies the given question here, right? So we simply substitute the answer options in the question one after the other, and the one that satisfies the given question can be taken as the correct answer. Let's understand this with the help of an example. Now here I have a question on ages, which says the ages of A and B are in the ratio of 7:4. After 5 years, the ratio of their ages become 11:7. What is the age of A? So here simply two ratios have been given. The first ratio is 7:4. The second ratio, which is after 5 years, becomes 11:7. And we have to find out what is the age of the person A here. And the given answer options are 12 years, 14 years, 15 years, and 28 years. Now, most of the students answer even this question using the traditional method and end up spending about 45 to 60 seconds to get the right answer. But if you are smart and if you use the substitution method, you can mark the answer for this question in less than 10 seconds. So what do we do here? Try to substitute the answer options back in the question. Well, the one point that you need to observe here is A is to B is in the ratio of 7:4. Their original ages are in the ratio of 7:4. Now, if you look at it, we can clearly understand that A's age has to be a multiple of 7. The age of the person A has to be a multiple of 7. Now, if you look at the answer options, option A, can we substitute this here? No, because 12 clearly is not a multiple of 7. So this gets ruled out. Let us now look at second option here. Second option says A's age is 14 years. So substitute A equals to 14. Now what happens if A is 14 years? It is a multiple of 7, right? So the first condition is satisfied. But the second condition says after 5 years, A's age has to be a multiple of 11. Now if we assume that 14 is the correct answer, 14 plus 5, that is A's age after 5 years would be 19. But is 19 a multiple of 11? No. So even this option gets eliminated. So basically we are substituting 14 back in the question to see if it satisfies both the conditions or not. Let us now substitute the third option, that is 15 years. A's age is 15 years. If you substitute 15 here, what happens? We'll say 15 by B equals to 7/4. But since most of the times the questions here should have the answer will be an integer value, we know that 15 is not a multiple of 7. So even this does not seem to be the right answer. So we can, you know, rule this answer out and look at the last option, 28 years. Since already three of the answer options have been eliminated, we can say that option 4 is the correct answer. By the way, if option 4 here, that is 28 years, or option D, 28 years, let's say is somewhere in the first position, then what do? Substitute back, right? 28 years. Let's substitute A equals to 28. Does that satisfy the first condition? Yes. A's age has to be a multiple of 7. 28 is a multiple of 7. Now what happens? The second part of the question says after 5 years, the ratio becomes 11:7. Now if A's age is 28 years, after 5 years it would become 33. 28 plus 5 is 33. Is that a multiple of 11? Yes, it is. So we see that the fourth option here, or option D here, satisfy both the conditions of the given question. Hence, this has to be the correct answer. So this is how in substitution method, we just try to substitute back the answers in the given question and see which option satisfies the question, the conditions given in the question. And let us now see the fourth method of answering questions from aptitude. And this method is known as elimination method. Now what exactly happens here? We don't find out the correct answer. Instead, we find out what are the wrong answers. That is, to eliminate the wrong answer options. We know that we have got four answer options here, out of which one is correct and three are wrong. So we either find out the correct answer or find out which three are wrong. And there are many questions where finding out the three wrong answers would be much, much easier than finding out the one correct answer there. And these type of questions can be answered using elimination method. Let's understand this method with the help of a simple example here. Now this question from simplification says, (+79^2 = 172^(-88^2) - (8203). And we have to find out what comes in place of question mark. Again, if you go by the traditional method, we'll end up wasting a lot of time, right? Following the conventional method will take at least 1.5 to 2 minutes for us to get the required answer. If you do not know how to find out the squares of a number mentally. However, we know that we'll not be following traditional method here. Instead, we'll use elimination method. That is to eliminate the wrong answers from the given answer options. Now, how do we do that in this question? Follow the unit digit method. What we do here is find out what can be the unit digit of the given question. And based on that, we can eliminate the wrong answers. Let's do that. We know that when a number ends in 9, its square would end in 1. Any number that ends in 9, the square of that number would end in 1. Because 9 squared is 81, right? 19 squared is 361. 29 squared is 841. So always when a number ends in 9, the square ends in 1. So we know that 79 square is a number that ends in 1. It will be a 4-digit, 5-digit number that ends in 1. 4-digit number that ends in 1. Now, let us follow a similar procedure for the remaining numbers as well. 172 squared. When a number ends in 2, its square ends in 4. Likewise, 88 square. When a number ends in 8, its square also ends in 4. Right? So these are, you know, 4-digit numbers that end in 4. And this last number here is 8203, which is a straightforward number that ends in 3 here. Alright, now let us try to do the simplification. We have to find out what comes in place of question mark here, right? Now the idea here is to balance the unit spaces on both the sides. If you look at the right hand side, there is a number that ends in 4 minus another number ending in 4. Now one number ends in 4, the other number also ends in 4. When we take the difference, we know that it will end in 0. For example, 124 minus 74 would end in 0. 4 minus 4 gives us 0. So 4 minus 4 here is 0. Now we have a number that ends in 0 minus a number that ends in 3. Now one number ends in 0 and the other number ends in 3. The result would end in, don't say minus 3. If you know the concept here, you'll say that it ends in 7. Because what do? We borrow 1 from the next digit, make it 10. And 10 minus 3 will give us 7. So clearly the right hand side of this equation ends in 7. If the right hand side ends in 7, it is obvious that the left hand side should also add up to 7. Now already we have a number that ends in 1. So what should come in place of the unit place of question mark square so that it is 7? See, 1 + 6 will be equal to 7. So clearly question mark square should be ending in 6. Now we know that question mark square ends in 6, right? Some number squared ends in 6. So what can be the unit space of that number? It can be either 4 or 6, right? When a number ends in 6, if we take square root on both the sides, what do we get? Question mark will be equal to square root of some number ends in 6, ending in 6. And when a number ends in 6, its square root ends in either 4 or 6. So now we are pretty clear that the question mark should be a number that ends in either 4 or 6. Let's check that from the answer options. Option A, number ends in 6. So maybe the right answer. Look at option B, ends in 9. Can this be the correct answer? No, eliminated. Option C, ends in 3, eliminated. Option D, also ends in 3, eliminated. So we see that option B, C and D cannot be the correct answers because the correct answer has to either end in 4 or 6. And now that we are left with only one choice, we can say that it has to be the correct answer. So the answer for this question is 86 following the elimination method. So this is how, based on the question, we can apply any of these four methods, that is the traditional method or method of using your basic concepts and fundamentals, or the elimination method or the substitution method, to find out the answer. Now you should follow this approach and understand which method suits for the given type of question. And the only way to do that is practice more and more on various types of aptitude questions. So I hope all of you have followed the four different ways of solving questions from aptitude. Now all you need to do is practice more and more and make sure that you apply the best method out of these four methods to solve the given question and arrive at the given answer without any difficulty. See you in the next video. Thank you.